to that visually. Hi there, I'm Miguel Concepcion, editor here over at GameSpot, and we are here with the developers from Arachnid Games.
Hi, Leo.
Leo. Jacob and Leo, and they are here to show Diluvion. Yep. Guys, I was hoping we can get started in, we can start off by having you guys talk about what Diluvion is.
Yeah, Diluvion is sort of an underwater fantasy where you take the role of a captain of your own submarine. A lot of it's about exploring this flooded world, and there's this whole kind of backstory of like what caused the flood, and everyone has their own theories. But the gameplay is like building up your crew, and there's like salvaging and battles, a couple creatures. So, yeah.
So our characters, were they experienced in navigating and piloting a submarine before the flood, or did the flood necessitate them to?
So the world's been flooded for hundreds of years. We like to think of it in a way that nobody alive today in this world knows anybody that was alive during the flood.
Okay.
And so the reasons for why it happened is kind of like gone away, and then more the necessity of surviving in this kind of extremely harsh environment has taken over like theories or how to even get to the surface anymore.
So but they know there is a surface.
Yeah, they must be. But it's the whole world's been covered by ice, like okay. Miles and miles of thick ice, so nobody's seen the surface for hundreds of years.
Yeah, they tell legends of the surface, but nobody that's alive has seen it.
Okay.
So yeah, it's kind of this like mystical, like the upper world type of thing.
Should we get started?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Start with...
So going into this, I already know it has this steampunk aesthetic, but it's not alternate history. It's a totally new world.
It's like a near kind of sci-fi aesthetic to it.
Yeah, early on we had kind of toyed around with the idea of like setting it in a real world location. But then that kind of introduced a lot of things that we felt like, it's not important that particular place is in there. Like.
Yeah.
I feel like if you introduce a location, then you're also introducing the themes that have to do with that location. And it's like, those aren't the themes that we're dealing with here.
Yeah. Looks like we're not starting from the very beginning of the game.
No. We're starting, like, it's close to the beginning. This is the first zone that we call the Forgotten Fjords. Okay. It's the zone that's closest to the ice. So you see everywhere you go, like, you have this roof of ice above you. And you basically start off as a podunk captain trying to make your luck and just start off with like a little rusty tin can and then try and fill it up with your crew and trying to upgrade your sub so you can go even deeper.
Oh.
Well, so, you're already engaging in combat.
Yeah.
One minute into gameplay.
This is, at this point, he's like salvaging for parts to upgrade his sub. And this is a sort of old salvage yard, so there's other people looking for it.
Yeah. And all the battles are in real time?
Yes.
Yeah.
So real time, plays similar to like any space sim, if people are familiar with it. So yeah, we defeated this guy, one of his crew who got left behind. Let's see if I can afford it. Yeah. So you go around, you can defeat people, defeat enemies, sometimes they drop loot, and sometimes they'll have survivors, and you do all this to build up your crew and kind of increase your power level over the gameplay.
I'm thinking of Dragon Ball Z. We should go through a little bit slowly because we're going over like a lot of stuff.
Yeah, we did go over a lot of stuff. Well, first of all, if you don't decide to recruit someone, they're just stranded there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
You can actually blow up the crippled ship so that you end their misery.
Okay.
if you're that kind of captain.
And you can still take the loot without taking and without recruiting.
Yeah.
Okay. And yeah, it looks like you probably have a limit on how much crew you could have.
That's right. So the green station is your kind of the heart of the sub. That's we actually call it the heart station in the code, but it's the crew quarters. And this is what determines like how many crew you can have, and this is where they'll rest. And it's also how you heal your sub.
Okay.
Because any crew that are in this station will repair damage to your sub.
Right.
And then we have like these different colored spheres around the sub, and each one of those represents a different sort of task. So, like, there's up here's like the weapon station, and like you put more people in there to increase your accuracy and fire rate. Then we've got like the helm, which, in like, you can increase your engine power and overdrive, which is like allows you to do short boosts. And then there's the sonar, which is like detecting other threats and other salvage around the zone.
Oh, so your crew factors in into the stat increase.
Yeah, exactly.
Stat increases of your submarine.
Yeah, it's like the number one thing that affects how your sub does.
Okay.
So it's really important to kind of like know your crew, and each of them has these sort of stats, and their stats determine what they're good at. So taking more time, you can get a good idea of like, oh, this guy's a really good match for weapons because of his stats.
Now, going back to the crew quarters, and you talking about them needing to rest, how does that factor into the overall gameplay? I mean, is there, can you like exhaust, like, can characters get tired if you don't make them rest?
Or yeah, crew don't get to rest.
What's the goal of the crew quarters?
The crew quarters is where you send them. If they're in the crew quarters, they'll help out with general repairs. So that's the main way of getting your health back, is by putting crew into the crew quarters. And then over time, they'll spend time repairing your sub and getting you back up to shape.
Okay.
Yeah, they don't have like endurance, or like they don't have a bar that depletes and then they need to rest. Although if you run out of food, they'll stop working in your stations.
Yeah.
So they'll all just kind of like hang out in the crew quarters and
strike,
not do anything.
Okay. So focusing on the exploration, it looks like the ships that you can find are ships that you fight, plus ships that are that have long since been stranded that you're hoping to salvage and maybe find some leftover loot.
Yeah,
right?
Absolutely.
That's right.
And what other elements of just exploring the sea in general can we? What else can we talk about?
So we have sort of a landmark system. So as you're exploring, like, you'll find these different landmarks, which are each kind of like a unique, one-of-a-kind part of the landscape.
Mm-hmm.
And that's actually what you use to navigate, because the zones are really big. So we have a compass here, and this should have some of the landmarks. Yeah, so when you discover a landmark, it appears on your compass. And that's really helpful because there's, like, we have a map, but it's not... It doesn't show your position in the world. We kind of leave out your position intentionally because we want people to use the landmarks and kind of use that navigation system.
Are there breadcrumbs or hints that that can possibly tease you as to where the landmarks are? Or do you just have to just explore like in one direction?
Yeah, the fish will actually kind of gather around landmarks. So there's a special kind of fish that's like kind of golden and glowy, and you can see them from a distance around a landmark.
Okay.
Yeah.
This one's pretty tough. There you go. Okay, nice. So we can talk about the map for a second, yeah. So as you see, they have the map. We're in all the way to the right here. Near this Rheinfjord relic. As we said, we don't really show where the player is on the map, but by finding these landmarks around the world, you can kind of like surmise where you are and then use your compass to navigate from one landmark to the other to kind of like figure out where you need to go.
Cool. So one of the things you brought with us is this really...
Oh, yeah.
Interesting and elaborate keyboard that we at GameSpot are actually giving away here.
Let me see if I can get a good view for the camera. All right, here we go. Yeah, so this is like a steampunk keyboard made by Datamancer.
Oh, so this sexy. Like fits with the steampunk aesthetic of the game.
Yes.
How did you guys come up with it?
I mean, we didn't really design it.
Yeah.
We just kind of, Datamancer is a custom keyboard and like a PC peripheral company in Seattle, I think.
No, they're...
I'm not quite sure where
they're from. We should probably not give them wrong. Yeah, I think they're in California. But I don't know specifically where.
Oh, so this was already designed not in conjunction with the game, but...
We basically just like told them what the game was about. It's like kind of steampunky, do something steampunky, and then they took it from there and kind of designed this beautiful thing.
Yes.
Any particular functions here that you can't find in a regular keyboard, or is it pretty...
I think it's straight up just a keyboard, yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty standard key layout, although it is nice, like, mechanical keyboard in here, so...
And for your viewers who want to enter to potentially win this keyboard, we recommend going to the GameSpot Twitter, where you will find the link to this contest.
Mm-hmm. We also have the mouse. I don't know if you saw that one yet.
Oh, yeah, we do need to show the mouse.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So the mouse is really cool because it was made from like an old Morse
machine. An actual Morse machine, yeah.
Yeah, you can see like up here the buttons are from a Morse machine.
Yeah.
So yeah, I really like the mouse. Our publisher sent us these through the mail and I was really tempted to just like take it and put another keyboard in here.
So I'm sorry, can we take a look at the mouse again? Because obviously we can see the buttons that represent the left and right click. Right. But is there a scroll wheel?
Yeah, there's a little scroll wheel in the middle here.
Okay.
That scrolls like that, and then there's the two buttons like at the edge here.
Yeah, and the palm rest is a nice touch.
Yeah, exactly. It's more fancy probably than most machines back in the day. That's cool.
Nice. So again, if you go to our Twitter at GameSpot, you'll be able to find the link to this live stream and instructions on how to enter this contest.
Let me see. Yeah, the box is really cool too. It's like laser cut, solid stuff.
I should ask, how many of these did you make?
Two.
Okay.
Two each, I think.
They're like...
It's two of a kind.
Yeah.
No, they're each like kind of unique.
Okay.
So it's actually like one of a kind.
They're one of a kind.
Yeah.
There's a big difference. Yeah, I didn't notice.
I think the keyboards are slightly different, each of them.
But the mice are both have that Morse code.
Yeah, and
design.
They both have
just
the same.
Just to be clear, we didn't make these.
Right.
These are made by a company called Datamancer.
Okay.
Which I think our publisher hooked us up with them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, going back to the gameplay, I think where we left off, we were talking about the map and exploration.
Oh, yeah.
So, and the landmarks. Is that part of the goal setting that the player makes for themselves in terms of like setting long-term goals? Is landmark, I assume finding the landmarks is one of them, but can you tell us more about what kind of goals the player will set for themselves?
Yeah. So... I guess I'll start off by saying, like, there's goals that we set for them. Like, there's a entire campaign and quest line.
Mm-hmm.
As far as goals that players set for themselves, what we've seen so far is, like, their goals are usually oriented to crew. Like, they want to get crew with really good stats or oriented to subs. Because right now we have a sub, and this one can be upgraded. Each sub has sort of three upgrade levels.
Okay.
But then there's also two other subs that have their own upgrade levels. So we've seen people that want to get like all the subs fully upgraded.
Now, we just had an encounter there.
Yeah, I'm just leaving because I don't want to fight.
Okay.
I'm downstream from him, so I don't really want to fight him in that situation.
It's hard to do. What's the likelihood of coming across some ships that are just like too powerful for you to... engage and succeed.
I'd say like 1 in 10, maybe.
Okay.
But by the end of a zone, usually you start off with fairly weak, and then you kind of build yourself up until you get to a power spike at the end of a zone, and then you can usually take on everybody.
Oh, we should mention this landmark down here.
Oh yeah.
So that we have like a visual to show. No.
I'll just do the crab. That one's a nicer look at.
Yeah. So there are a few ships out there that like if you're going out deep away from towns. They will just wreck your shit.
Literally.
Wait, can I swear on this? Is that okay?
I believe so.
Okay, cool. Retrospectively. Yeah, there's like really, really difficult subs, but actually the more difficult ones, if you're able to cripple those, they have some pretty good loot.
Yeah. So this is an example of a landmark. And what they are in the game are just unique looking features in the world that they just decided to use as landmarks to find, to like help them navigate the world. And so when you get close to them, your captain kind of uses intuition and it comes out in the form of these like glowing fish to tell you where to go. But it won't tell you exactly where to go, but it'll tell you the next landmark in a chain on where you need to go. This guy keeps following me.
I assume, yeah, there will be some of these ships and pirates are going to be pretty persistent in taking you down.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah, we have a few different personalities. So some of them will just kind of like, they'll only mess with you if you get close, whereas some will just chase you down.
Yeah, some will not necessarily be pirates. They'll just be other scavengers like you, but they kind of want the prize the same way you do. And so they'll fight you for it.
Well, speaking of personalities, maybe we can talk more about your crew interactions. I mean, we're getting these pop-ups on the lower right,
yeah,
where they're just interacting with each other.
Yeah, so when the crew wants your attention, they have little chatter boxes come up in the bottom right corner. Red ones means it's something related to a quest, or he'll point you to where you need to go. But otherwise, they'll just kind of like either just react to something that's happening out in the world or just talk to you about fluff.
So they're reacting, they're also giving you information, but is there any kind of like choices, like dialogue choices, or kind of like narrative paths?
Not like a dialogue tree. There's the choices you see are like, these are all the things that they want to talk to you about. But yeah, there's not like a dialogue tree system where it determines.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's see, yeah, so I'm pretty low on health now, so I'm gonna put some crew back. You can talk a little bit about captain time too, Leo.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. I'll wait till combat for that.
Yeah.
Are you going to the Sonar Guild?
I'm not quite sure. I haven't been trying to do anything in particular. I've just been flying around and then trying to explain everything that's been going on.
Yeah.
Are there, at least in starting out, are there waypoint markers to help you get to like the first couple landmarks, or does it give you any kind of carrots or?
Yeah, so when you're first starting out, these golden fish will guide you directly to your destination.
Okay.
And then when you get into the wider open ocean, the fish will stick around for a certain amount of time. And you kind of have to like use a skill of navigation and look on your compass and be like, okay, I know the next step is in this direction. So you're kind of like connecting the dots between different landmarks.
Well, you're using terms like compass, and I see these sort of these streamlines. How much of, let's talk more about the what things in reality helped influence this game, things that just about the ocean that you guys felt like you had to put in.
You worked on some, a ship, so you
selective realism.
Yes, yeah, definitely selective realism. Yeah, I mean, the not having a waypoint basically came from... I played WoW back in the day, and I played Skyrim back in the day. And I noticed, especially Skyrim, which was much later, I ended up just looking at the compass half the time. Like, instead of looking at the world, I was just looking at the top little corner of my screen, because it will always tell you exactly what direction to go in. Which kind of grew... Like, it was very efficient, and I do power game really hard, but I kind of, I felt like I missed out on a bunch by doing that. And so that's where the inspiration came to kind of like come up with this, oh shit.
So what's the proper nautical term for this gas and brake UI on the left?
Just like full half.
I think it's
flow.
Just the throttle, isn't it?
Yeah, it's just the throttle, yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
That's what they call it?
Okay. Yeah, so it's styled like an old steamship kind of thing where you send messages to the engine. So you basically send that to your helmsman, and then he makes sure that the engine gets it. Oh, so we can get him to run into that mine.
No, dude, you should talk about your time on a ship.
Oh yeah, no,
too,
I mean,
I think that add part of
it. I'm originally Norwegian, and so seafaring is a big part of our culture. And I've worked on a lumber ship at one point from Finland to Egypt, and it's just like. There's a lot of like interesting things that doesn't get covered very often. And since we were already doing kind of like an underwater nautical game, I wanted to kind of get as much detail or trying to get inspired as much as possible to show people something new, something different.
Yeah, and we kind of had to find a good balance between like what is something new we can bring into it that's right. inspired by real world nautical or like, I think one of the guys we talked to when we were developing worked on a submarine.
He told us a lot
about
submarine. Oh, yeah, that was excellent. We had at one of the shows, we had an actual U.S. Navy, I think it was like an officer or a sailor. He worked on a submarine. He was like nerding out with us about like all the submarine details that we got right and all the ones that we got wrong.
Yeah.
And we talked about like the compromises we've been doing.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's always a balance between like that sort of realism and the cool things in real ships and like having it be approachable to new players. Cause like you don't want to just overload them with all these details.
Yeah, if I had the choice, I would definitely put even more navigation stuff in here, but because we kind of wanted to make it a little bit more easily approachable and easily, like the sub started feeling more and more, it started off as like more of a simulation kind of thing, like they have much heavier turn rates, they were kind of really hard to control and it was very frustrating.
Right.
And so we made it a little bit easier to control some of the subs. I mean, this one's the most controllable sub, can turn almost on a dime. And the bigger subs you get, the slower the turn rate they have, but it felt better kind of making it feel more like the Warthog and Halo than the Silent Hunter series ships.
So both Halo and Silent Hunter in some degree have influenced this game.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
I'd imagine, I mean, given that there are not that many nautical exploration games.
Yeah.
I can't help but think that maybe like even like space exploration games might have.
Oh, absolutely,
informed this.
I mean, the first conversation when we started talking about this game, we wanted to do freelancer was what I was thinking about. It's like, hey, it'd be easy to do freelancer, which is turned out to be extremely wrong. But we also found that there are a lot of really good space games coming out. Like Elite Dangerous was on its way out, and like Star Citizen is also on its way, and we can't really compete with that because we're three people. So we wanted to shift to like, hey, what about like, what's a different setting that'll make this kind of stand out? And then it's like submarines. And then we just kind of started making submarines for like a year to see what that felt like. And then kind of the rest of the design just was informed from that, just playing around with submarines in this style of gameplay.
Now we're looking at these, you know, between the mines that I've seen and the other ships, what other hostilities can we anticipate?
Oh, this would be. Can I load in the abyss scene?
Oh yeah, for sure. Yeah, yeah. We can go. That's probably better for later in the game because the first two, it's mostly other ships and
yeah,
that kind of junk.
There's a lot of creatures that you come across, and this kind of has to do with the lore of the game. But there's creatures that are sort of like a mix of biological and mechanical, and that. That has to do with the story, and I won't get too into that because I don't want to spoil anything. But
maybe that's going to be the theme of this year because I also think about Horizon Zero Dawn. Anything about those?
Yeah.
Those enemies.
So maybe you want to do Abyss or just Sunken Coast for a little bit?
Head down to the Abyss. Yeah. I think you can go there in this sub.
Yeah.
So we're in a much deeper part of the ocean now. We can see on our depth meter. It's like 800 some meters down.
Yeah,
I should ask, how does the map color in as you explore? I mean, how much is revealed if you have the map versus how much is revealed through just general exploration?
Well, the map is fully revealed to you when you find it.
Okay.
In every zone that you get to, there's a map somewhere that you kind of have to find. And then as you discover new landmarks, those get added to your map.
Yeah. So the coloring in is just kind of finding out where these landmarks are.
Yeah. And like the map, it represents depth by lightness. So if you go back to the map, you can see like what are the shallow areas of the zone and what are the deep areas. So this zone has like a massive trench in the middle.
So I imagine there's like creatures and objects that are exclusive to different depths.
Yeah,
I assume. Does it also? Is it safe to assume that the deeper you go, the more dangerous it can be?
Absolutely.
Yes.
That was one of the core tenets of the game that we wanted to do is just make it scarier and more dangerous the deeper you go.
Yes, so we come across some creatures here. This should answer your question about if it's more dangerous. They go at you, man.
Oh, shit.
It's called a Jaeger? Is that another ship?
No, that's actually a creature. So we're up against a Jaeger and two drones right now.
Jaegers and drones that shoot lasers.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I like to think of it more as like radioactive snot that they just forcefully eject. Because they are, they're biological.
Right.
And these are the ones I was talking about where they're a mix of bio and mechanical.
Influenced by real life sea life.
Mm-hmm, absolutely.
Yeah, there's this fish, I forget what it's called, but it has like a transparent head.
Right.
The eyes are inside the head.
Yeah, they're like right in the middle and they can like pivot up. And that's what these guys are based off of. But wow, the fish is freaky.
Yeah.
Did you see Blue Planet?
No.
The series? That was
I know
like
of it.
Everyone on the team when we were first starting this watched Blue Planet because it's just like there's so much cool stuff about the ocean that you usually don't hear about or encounter. So that added a lot of inspiration about like the especially the deeper zones because that's like a really recent sort of we've all seen the coral reef like photos and videos, but
right.
You know, the deeper stuff, it's pretty new.
So in case you're just joining us, I am Miguel Concepcion, editor at GameSpot. I am here with Jacob and Leo from Arachnid Games, and we are looking at Diluvion. One of the cool things that they brought with them, which we are actually giving away on GameSpot, is this...
Can I show it again?
Yes.
Yes,
it's
okay, yeah.
A one-of-a-kind keyboard and a two-of-a-kind mouse. That is steampunk themed, specific to the game. And if you go on GameSpot's Twitter, you'll be able to find the link on how you could potentially win this. We should definitely show that mouse again.
Yeah, yeah.
Here's the mouse.
Oh, shit.
Gonna interrupt everything and
stop it.
Yeah, the mouse has a cool like wooden scroll wheel, and it's made out of Morse machines. So it's got the. It's kind of hard to see, but yeah, right there. So yeah, it's pretty cool, and you can win it somehow.
Yes, by going to GameSpot's Twitter account, you'll be able to find the link on how to enter, and
put this away again. Somebody will actually get it in a non-broken way. There you go.
Do you want to switch, or are you good?
No, I'm good.
Cool.
That's better.
So
yeah, the deeper you go as well, the harder it becomes to see things. And so the sonar becomes more and more important the deeper you go.
Are there any other visual enhancement tools, like maybe brighter headlights, or you're primarily relying on the sonar?
You're depending on the sonar. Okay. And as you go on, like you put more crew in your sonar station, it becomes more and more powerful and you can get a longer range. And basically the better contact you have with your sonar, the more effective your weapons are because your gunners and your torpedo men are using the sonar signature in order to get a lock on.
Yeah.
As you're kind of threading the needle here, I guess we do have to be concerned about collision damage.
Oh yeah, for sure. Yeah, if you ram into things too hard, you can actually take a whole bunch of damage.
Yeah, I like using that in combat. Like,
what are we approaching here? Is this a landmark?
This is a town.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's also a landmark, but yeah, this is one of the towns. This is actually the main town in the Abyss because like it's very sparsely populated down here. So the people just kind of live in these like cramped settings. There's also, we kind of get into this more in the plot, but like each zone has their own kind of like civilization. And the people of the Abyss have this religion that they believe in where they worship something called the Deep. And that plays into like the stories of like how did the world get flooded, because their religion attempts to explain it.
Is it just the one religion in the game, or are there competing religions?
There's one that we talk about, there's multiple belief systems.
Okay.
So like we also have the people up near the ice, and we actually just call them icers. But they're very like scientific.
Mm-hmm.
Logical, kind
of. Yeah, scientific, logical, and their sort of belief that keeps them going is that they can drill through the ice. So they put their faith in technology to like get through the ice and escape to see the surface. And to them, it's really like the only chance that humanity has. Things in the ocean aren't doing so well.
Yeah.
So what are some of the things you can do in the town?
You can hire crew members. There's quests there. You can trade with the merchants. You can swap out ships. Depending on the town, some of them have mechanics where you can upgrade your ship.
Right. But not all of them.
No, not all of them.
Okay.
Yeah, there's gonna be a lot of fluff characters too that you just talk to. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and there are certain points where you can like learn more about your crew. Like this town, one of our crew members is actually from this town, so.
Yeah. The Comic Sans, I just noticed.
You just noticed that?
Go.
Okay, sorry. We,
Are you talking about the font?
Yeah, the font on the order here. It's a Comic Sans.
I'm not a fan.
Yeah, no.
I mean, I'm not a fan either, but. Okay.
Yeah, no, we.
That's not final.
No, it is. It was very intentional.
It's a nice contrast to the. It wasn't lost on me. It seems like the primary font you're using is very Final Fantasy.
Oh, yeah.
Is it?
Good eye. Yes, that was intentional.
That's all Leo.
So I'm a big fan of the series. I have been for many years.
Did you already beat 15?
Uh-huh. No. I shouldn't get into that here. I have a lot to say about that game.
Okay.
I don't love it and I don't hate it, but I have a lot to say about it. But we're talking about Diluvion.
Yes.
I don't know. It's a fantasy game, and we want that to be clear. And I think having a font that's similar shows.
So I noticed these. Are these tubes that I see, like the streams that help navigate through the world?
Oh, the red ones here?
No,
these tubes?
Yeah.
Those are just underwater streams, kind of.
Right.
So they're like fast travel lanes. Anyway, they make speed you up. And by learning where they go and where they end up, you can travel around pretty effectively.
But your fast travel doesn't, you're not allowed like instantaneous
fast travel. No, absolutely not.
Okay. Can you speak about the size of the world and how that relates to the total playtime that someone could have?
Yeah, so in this past like 10 seconds that you've been in this fast travel lane, if we pull up the map here, that was...
Trevor's Edge to like halfway down, I think.
No, that was...
Yeah, I think we're
at like point.
I think we're just getting to the river.
It's big.
Yeah.
That was about a fifth of the way across.
Yeah. So it's like three of these large kind of open free roaming zones.
Yeah, so I don't really have a good approximation. I think in kilometers it's like 10 or 12 across.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah.
Let's see.
This zone in particular is deeper than the other ones
because
it's focused on a trench. It's very loosely based off the Mariana Trench.
Okay.
But of course, the Mariana Trench didn't have like weird, gigantic glowing crabs and strange creatures.
Is that what the swarmers are?
Yeah. The swarmers are sort of kamikaze like. They're not really based on a creature in particular.
Okay.
Yeah, they're bad news.
Right. Well, I guess we should be grateful they're not as aggressive as they.
Yeah.
As you make them out to be.
Yeah. I mean, I'm gotten pretty good at handling every single one of these guys at this point.
Now we got these five icons on the lower left.
Yeah.
Let's go through. Let's talk about.
So these are your resources. You have scrap metal, which is just used for the main cannons, and it's also used for, like, if you're upgrading your sub, you can use scrap metal and a few other things.
Got a lot of friends.
Oh wow. You went to the wrong part of town, my friend. Next to that, we have the air tank.
Right.
And I feel like that's pretty self-explanatory.
Right, and you have three units left. Should we be concerned?
Each one lasts pretty long.
Okay.
So it's getting down there.
Should we be escaping? Can we just, like,
just run away, yeah.
Yeah, can we, like, go into the stream? And make a quick getaway? I mean, they're not going to chase you.
Oh, shit. Oh, they will. They will.
Okay. Now I'm thinking about those scenes in Star Trek where they have, like, fights during when they go to hyperspace.
Oh, yeah. No, these guys, once you get them angry, they don't stop. The human enemies that you meet, like the captains and other submarines and stuff, you can run away from them and eventually they'll just kind of, like, forget it. But the creatures, no. Yeah, the one next to that is food. So food we talked about earlier, where the more crew you have, the more food you're going to go through. So yeah, keep an eye on that. And then there's repair kits. So if you have repair kits, your crew can repair a lot faster than they normally would be able to.
Can they repair even if you had zero repair kits?
Yeah, they can,
yeah,
but it's just
slower, much slower.
Yeah, a crew member repairs like one HP.
I'm actually dying. That was more than I thought.
Got him. Nice.
Yeah, so I'm using it. There's a bunch of different weapons as well.
You're screwed.
I'm fine.
You're screwed.
Okay, I should try and do this thing.
Yeah, get some crew in there so they can repair. So he's using captain's time right now, which is you can actually slow down time for a short period. Okay.
But it's not fully paused.
No, it's not fully paused, but
correct.
It's enough to slow down so you can, like, get some people into the repair kit, into the repair bay.
Yeah.
And I have a lot of repair kits, so I think I'll be okay.
I'm surprised I didn't ask this sooner, but are there allied ships?
Yeah, there will be times where there's very few times where it's, like, specifically your ally, but that does happen. Mostly what you'll come across is, like, if you're, let's say you come across, like, a merchant and a pirate. You and the merchant can fight against the pirate.
Okay.
But yeah, merchants usually, they won't attack you unless you attack them first.
And if you're near towns, aside from here, like, there'll usually be a guardian or something in the town that'll attack pirates on site. So if you're being bullied a lot and you're near a town, that's an option that you can just run straight to the nearest town and then the guards will take care of whoever's chasing you.
Yeah, I do that a lot, like, early in the game where it's like you don't have a great ship and, like, some pirates after you. Just, like, lead them into town, and then the guards just mess them up.
So, yeah, the merchants, the friendly merchants, you guys are on the same page. Whenever there's a hostile pirate, they'll automatically, like, help you out.
Yeah, well, most merchants will try and run, but if it's, like, a guard or a military-type ship, then they will help you out, you know, against pirates.
Yeah. The pirates, they're usually pretty dumb. Like, they'll attack merchants, regardless of what kind of ship the merchant is in, so you'll come across, like, a pirate and a merchant, and the merchant's just wrecking the pirate.
Let's talk about the loot. I noticed you had this one page that just showed what you've been collecting.
Yeah, this stuff, yeah.
Yeah, so a lot of these are the resources you saw at the bottom. Sometimes you just find treasures that are good for, like, selling off for a lot of cash. And there's the key items up top. So these are, like, the different landmarks that you find. You get a chart for each of these.
These are, like, collectibles, yeah.
Yeah, and there's actually a cartographer's guild that you can bring the charts to, and they'll pay out for them.
There's also weapons, the new weapons that you find also end up here.
So yeah. Some key items are best sold.
Well, you can't sell key items,
okay.
But you find like treasures that basically their only purpose is just to sell them.
Right.
And a lot of salvaging is that, where like you just find one of the main treasures is like different types of plants. Mm-hmm. There's like a fern and a tomato plant, which is like in this realm where there's no surface, plants are highly valued because they're very difficult to grow without sunlight. Mm-hmm.
So what kind of interaction are we seeing here?
This is a story.
So there's this ship. I'm going to try and say this without any spoilers. Basically, there's this ship that's been hunting you. At this point in the story, it's been hunting you for a while. And it has to do with the background of one of the characters. So they're just kind of talking about that. And the other crew, Allison, who's this kind of like sarcastic sonar officer, she's kind of like suspicious of this crew member, and she's like, what is the deal with this? Like, why is this person chasing us?
No, but are those characters that automatically join your crew, or does that story thread only occur when you've chosen to recruit them?
Those characters, like, they join your crew as part of the story.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, I've been moving.
Oh, he made it. He almost died.
running out of air. Yeah. So yeah, the air kind of limits how long you can go out on missions, and so usually you go out in a loop to get a bunch of stuff and try and get it to be as effective as possible before coming back to dock and sell stuff and then go back out again.
But if you understand the map well enough, you could just go from town to town.
Yeah.
In between.
So yeah, you could definitely plan routes like that and be extremely efficient in the way that you move around. This guy doesn't sell any air, actually. Air canisters are pretty rare.
But you did end up getting a refill anyway.
Yes, I did.
Despite docking.
Yeah, and you can get a random amount of air as well from docking with the thing with the dockables that you find while salvaging and also killing enemies, but. At this stage in the game, when you have this many crew members, like, you drain air really fast. And so, yeah, that's a really good gun.
What do you have?
I have the croc.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, the croc's
really good. I just blew this guy out completely. I'm taking a close
look. Let's get in close, yeah.
Let's take a nice close look at one of these guys.
What is...
So this is one of the creatures that he just shot down.
Okay.
So this is, like, its body.
Is there anything worth salvaging?
No, this guy...
Not in this one. Some of the creatures you can salvage.
No, we've been spending quite a bit of time in the deep sea section. Mm-hmm. Is there... should we go up a little higher?
We can give it a go, yeah.
You want to go to the sunken coast?
Yeah, let's
can do we? That. Can we surface?
No, but we... I mean, we can go to the... There's three big zones in this game. And so the deep sea section and the fjords that we showed just earlier, and then there's one more. Whoa. There's some battle going on out in the open water. Let's see what that is.
Oh, it's great that there are all these like battles going on independent of you.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
I think this is a traitor that's been attacked by swarmers. I don't think I saved him. I didn't get there in time.
That's probably not the right gun for swarmers.
Yeah. Swap to this one.
There it is.
Still bullying him. He's dead. Leave him alone.
I think he can loot it.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, I'm sorry you died. I'll just take your stuff now. You're not going to use it anymore.
Is anyone left?
No.
That is a common occurrence.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Looting. The ships that were killed by the sea life.
And then not leave any evidence.
Leaving little evidence.
Yeah, let's see.
Yeah. So, with the zones, there's these soft barriers, which basically take you to the world map.
Okay.
So we're gonna head to one of the other zones now.
So yeah, the three large zones. Sunken Coast is one that's in between. This is set on the kind of like what we imagine the old surface, so like where we are now in real life.
Okay.
That got completely flooded over, whereas the fjords are more higher up into the mountains.
Right.
That also got flooded. So, no matter where you are in the world, there's no winning. Everybody got flooded.
Yeah.
Oh, this is dark as well.
Yeah, I'm just coming out of the.
Okay.
The dark zones.
Yeah, it's kind of like the transition from the abyss into the sunken coast.
Let's see. See if I can put some more dudes in here.
Yeah. So Darren's in there.
So in case you're just joining us, I am here with Leo and Jacob from Arachnid Games. We are looking at Diluvion. And we are also here to give away this, let's see, I guess we call it one-of-a-kind keyboard and a two-of-a-kind mouse. themed on the steampunk aesthetic of the game. They have this like, it comes with this box with the laser etch title. And
there it is.
And we are giving this away on GameSpot's Twitter. If you go on the Twitter, you should be able to find the link for you to enter and potentially win this. This keyboard and this mouse, which is, the mouse itself is made up of an actual old Morse code parts.
Yeah. So it's like, yeah.
That, what, I guess the parts could potentially be like over 100 years old?
Yeah, I think that's what they told us, like they're really, really old parts, since nobody really uses Morse anymore. Well, outside of ships. Actually, Morse is still widely used in nautical stuff. They actually also carry everything you need to navigate by stars in case everything goes completely shitty, even on modern ships.
So they have a sextant?
Yes, they have sextant and star charts and like all the stuff that they can do to navigate by manually.
Do you still remember Morse code?
I do not. I never learned Morse code, sadly.
Okay.
No, when I worked on the ship, it was just as like a basic sailor. So there's a lot of banging rust out of iron stuff and cleaning, a lot of cleaning, the swabbing the decks. I think this is a piece of ice that's been sinking.
But it's not a landmark, technically.
No, this is
something that fell from the ceiling.
Is there anything worth salvaging?
No, not in this one.
Not on that one.
This is more of like a story point.
Yeah, so this is another example of a crew reacting to stuff happening in the world. So this is the previous zone, so we've pretty much explored all of this in the save file. So we have a bunch of landmarks here.
So yeah, I see these translucent red icons.
Yeah.
What do those denote?
Those are the landmarks.
Okay.
Yeah. So you can move towards those.
Oh, still you can find new ones.
Yeah.
Despite how much
you've
explored already.
Yeah. So there can always be like some that you missed that you can go back and find. And I think one of the achievements is finding every landmark and collecting the chart.
Right.
So this zone we imagine is like one of the most populous zones in the game. This is where the demographic called the Royals. And so there's a lot of people here, this is where most of the food gets produced. And it's kind of been split into several factions that are kind of vying for control over this, over the whole world here.
Let's talk more about those factions.
Yeah, so right now we're near Spiria, House Spirios, I think. Like a large, kind of like domed, these big bubble cities made with like special glass that are built on top of the skeletons of the old mega cities. So this could be like your San Francisco, New York of the future that got flooded and wrecked, and then people built kind of like another city inside that city.
I thought about Rapture for just a minute.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Brief second. Brief second there, yeah.
Sounds like a very friendly town by the music.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The music is very is most excellent. It communicates a lot of what we're trying to do with the game.
Oh, this guy has an air tag.
Oh, hell yeah.
Can I afford it?
Yeah, I think so. Oh, no, wait. Oh, yeah.
That's 50. Nice.
Yeah. Sounds like you can never have too many air tanks, but you probably have a maximum capacity.
Yeah. Well,
there's actually, no, like, there's very few maximum capacities in terms of stats and like, inventory stuff. Like, inventory is, like, a certain amount of capacity, but there are items that you can use to boost your crew member stats, like, in one way or another, and there's no upper limit to that. So you could just keep, if you feel like you're stuck or you're struggling, you can just kind of, like, stop for a while, go out, try and collect as much as possible, make money, and then kind of upgrade yourself so that you're a little bit stronger than what you need to be in order to progress the story. But there's no, we don't really like putting limits on that, like how much you can pimp out or break the game if you really want to. You need to use the compass, you're going out behind the...
Jacob mentioned that this is actually your second game. What was actually your first title?
Our first title was Ballpoint Universe.
Okay.
And that was a kind of hybrid platformer shoot-'em-up game. And the reason for the title is it was all the visuals were like ballpoint drawings. Mm-hmm. So it was just like we would draw doodles on notebook paper with ballpoint pen and scan it in. And that was sort of the entire visual style of the game.
Right. Oh, I asked because I was just wondering how, like, your first, how... I'm always curious how a studio's previous titles help inform the current one that you guys are working on. But based on how you describe it, it sounds like two totally different games.
Yeah, they are. Absolutely.
How did you guys come about with... how did you guys start, like, conceiving and planning Diluvion?
We always have sort of like game design conversations at lunch or just whenever.
Yeah.
And I think it was on a day when we were talking about space games.
I think I was eating a quesadilla.
Yeah, there's definitely quesadillas involved.
And your studio is based in the Bay Area?
So yeah, we're in Berkeley right now.
Okay. Yeah. So yeah, sure, Berkeley does have a lot of quesadilla options.
Yeah.
Yeah, so... we were talking about space games, and then that kind of led us to, like, ocean games.
That doesn't look friendly.
No. It's not friendly. That's why I'm not gonna... Oh, jeez. Yeah, I'm not gonna deal with that right now.
But this does bring the question, does the game present any kind of David and Goliath moments?
Oh, absolutely.
The maneuverability of your ship, can that be an advantage to the point you could actually conceivably take down?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Ships as large as that.
Yeah.
Yes.
That definitely comes up.
Without revealing too much.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, but how we came up with this, yeah, there's not a lot of overlap other than it has like an interesting visual style is like one of the key things that we want to deal with. Like Leo's originally an illustrator, and for me it's like I always want to have, I'm trying to learn how to do and make gameplay that it allows the player to kind of explore and break the game in different interesting ways. And I did most of the technical work on this game, so hopefully I've managed to at least give people a little bit of freedom in how they want to play it and how they want to pimp out their subs and their crew members.
How has the community response been?
Community response has been very good. It's actually one of the things that's been keeping us going, because this has been a 3-year cycle, which is at least 1 year too long. And we've been learning a lot on this game.
Although pretty common for indie titles.
Yeah, actually, yeah. I mean, Owlboy was like 10 years or something like that. That game looks amazing though. But yeah. I just can't even imagine what those people have been going through.
Is there anything you can share about the community feedback that actually has ended up in the game?
I'm trying to think of a specific example.
Yeah, I know we've had that.
A lot of the feedback we've gotten, we go to the, there's like a It's called gameplay something. But it's like, even when we go to PAX, we go to shows, we've been showing the game and getting a lot of feedback from that.
Oh, I know what you're talking about, yeah.
Yeah. It's game something, but I was thinking of gameplay space, but that's a different game something.
Yes, yeah, so the when we go to these shows and stuff, like, we have people play the game that have never played it.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, the way that navigation works with the landmarks and with the fish is all based on feedback from that. It's like the first couple times we showed, we had just kind of like baffled our players. And they were like, I don't know what to do. So when you're working in a project for a long time and like you know it front and back, it seems obvious to you.
Right.
And then you give it to someone and they're like, whoa, dude. Like, yeah. I don't know what this is.
Yeah.
Like, chill out.
I think, like, in terms of design, like, one of the main things was focusing on the exploration part.
Mm-hmm.
Came from just user feedback. Like, people were trying it out, and we noticed that they weren't really interested in fighting that much. They were more interested in going around, exploring, and finding stuff.
I was gonna ask that, because I'd imagine there'd be some fans that gravitate toward the exploration, some that gravitate toward the combat, but ideally, you guys would want to have someone who'd appreciate both.
Yeah, and we want one of the combat to be something that's rewarding and something that that's a choice, that you don't necessarily always make money, for example, on combat. Like, you can actually use more resources killing somebody than that you would get back from looting them. And that's intentional, because we want it to be a survival thing, that you're doing it to survive necessarily, not necessarily just to make money. Or just grind pirates like this.
Except for in this case. I know I can take these guys.
Yeah.
So it looks like there's some element of auto aiming, because I mean it's not easy to
turn it, no.
Yeah, and to, like, you know, aim and, you know, battle in this spherical space, especially when you're not looking from the perspective of a cockpit.
Yeah.
It looks like we got some weapons that actually have some heat seeking capabilities.
Yeah, so
this is the torpedo. And you can kind of charge up a torpedo by holding it in.
Right.
And as you charge it, it gets more unstable. So you're kind of taking a risk to give it, like, it'll be a lot more powerful, but it also might just, like, explode at any point on the way there.
And the auto-aim, as you mentioned about the auto-aim, the guns will try and point towards, you'll see that there's a little lead happening before them. Because the bolts have travel time, and so you can't aim at the ship, because by the time your bolts get there, then it would have passed by. And so your guns will try and aim. If you get your cursor over that lead, then we'll try and aim towards that. But that gets offset by kind of like how wavy you're moving. If you do like a really quick maneuver, your aim goes down.
I imagine there was probably an older build that where you guys toyed around with a radar or a minimap.
We never did a minimap, actually. I was really adamant about not having a minimap. But it wasn't like really that big of a discussion. This minimap, it's been done really well. Like, Elite Dangerous does it pretty well, where you have, like, it's a flat minimap, but then the dots kind of come off the map and, like, above or below to signify if they're around you. But we went for kind of like just marking them in the game space. You see, like, you know, in the top right, if you keep looking to the top right, you'll find something. That's been marked by your sonar guy. Let's see.
Now we see this icon of another landmark. Does that denote whether or not the place has been visited already, or
It will? No, that just means that it's closest. The closest one will have the name up and will be the biggest mark. So that's this little area right here is the landmark itself.
Yeah, if you haven't discovered it yet, it won't even appear on your compass.
Okay.
Let's check these guys before they notice you're here.
Got him.
Yeah,
there's different weapon types kind of catered to the different types of enemies that you'll face. Sort of like a long range, really powerful ones are terrible against swarmers because just like get right up on your face and they're small targets. So, well, this guy is very average across the board.
But he's free.
Yeah, but I don't have any more.
You can't have space.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess that's something you'll have to consider, you know, the value of someone who you come across early in the game versus later in the game.
Yeah, there's different places where you'll be able to find crew members that's like, they have a lot more points across the board. Mm-hmm. But yeah, they're like, they can get pretty expensive if they're a very skilled crew member.
What can you tell us more about these ruins?
So these are the ruins of House Morganson.
This used to be a city, but they were recently defeated in the story before you get to the zone. And so it's an important story point that you have like these kind of like dead, this dead city.
That emerged after the flood.
Yes. So yeah, all these houses, all this organization is stuff that's been happening after the flood.
Yeah, the organization itself, but the ruins, the actual structures are from the city before the flood. But the population of the city kind of formed into these different houses.
So this would be like different districts around the Bay Area. It would be like House Oakland versus House San Francisco and House San Jose.
So what's the next objective you're setting for yourself here?
I think this save is actually all the way at the end. So okay. I think like that's actually the last mission, I think.
Yeah.
Oh.
So there's no real, I don't think we want to end the game on stream.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mad spoilers.
We could sure. Jump back.
Yeah, this basically, we loaded into a save that's kind of at the end of the campaign so we can show off a lot of different areas. Is there somebody off of me right now?
Is there? You look pretty safe. It's actually been a pretty safe area.
Yeah.
You haven't been finding much hostile sea life as well.
Yeah, I think it was like hugging the outside for a long time when he was making his way around the zone. Let's see. Yeah, the sea life mostly comes into play towards the end, the last couple zones.
And I assume they respawn?
Oh, yeah. There's a respawn, and in fact, like a lot of the encounters get dynamically placed as you play through the game.
Okay.
And so it's not, they don't.
Does it adjust based on, does the difficulty adjust based on the stats of your submarine?
No, there's more just kind of like stuck to certain zones and certain depths. The deeper you go, it'll generally spawn in harder stuff.
Yeah.
And the more, yeah, the higher up you are, the less dangerous it'll be. And near towns, for example, there'll be less action happening. But it is procedural, so you can get lulls in the action.
Oh.
So it's not like some parts will be hand placed by the zones, by the following the story, and some of them will not be. Will just be kind of like placed around randomly.
This will be a good time to remind the viewers, in case you're just joining us. My name is Miguel Concepcion. I'm an editor at GameSpot, and we are here with
wrap it up.
Okay.
Yeah. Leo and Jacob.
Leo and Jacob.
Yeah, Leo and Jacob from Arachnid Games.
That's right.
Showing us Diluvion. We're going to be wrapping up, but before we do so, we'd like to remind you that we are having a giveaway for this one-of-a-kind keyboard and this two-of-a-kind mouse that they were nice enough to bring. The mouse is quite striking because it has parts from actual Morse code devices.
Mm-hmm.
And we should also show from one last time the keyboard. If you go to GameSpot's Twitter, you should be able to find a link where you can enter to potentially win this keyboard and mouse. Aesthetically themed on Diluvion's steampunk art style.
You look so concentrated, Leo.
I am. I had to kill these drones, man.
Yeah. The beautiful stuff.
Drones are beautiful keyboard. Business. So we'll be wrapping up here, guys. Thanks again for coming all the way from Berkeley.
All the way.
All the way.
Yeah, all the way.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Whoops.
Doggy.
Doggo is done.
Doggo. He's ready.
Excuse me.
All right.
Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Check it out. February 2.
February 2.
On Steam and GOG.
Steam and GOG.
Diluvion.
February 2nd.
Yes.
That's right. All right. Are we... Did we...